I'm really excited to welcome our guest tonight. We've been friends for a few years and always wanted her to come, but she's hustling and working all the time. But she's someone I've admired both her work and her mission for a long time. Ty is the founder and CEO of Friends at Work, an entertainment and social impact company that partners with leading creators, influencers, and brands to elevate important voices and help their visions thrive. Founded in 2015, LA-based Friends at Work supports the careers of artists including John Legend, Lindsey Stirling, Alanis Morissette, ex-ambassadors, and Fletcher, among others. Her company also advises organizations and individuals on social impact strategy, business development, creative storytelling, and production. Ty's work with John Legend began in 2006 with JL Ventures, where she created and developed artist-focused strategies for content innovation and social impact. Ty is a principal in John Legend's production company, Get Lifted Film Co., which served as executive producer on the Oscar-winning film La La Land and WGN's hit series Underground. Ty and John also started the Free America campaign to influence the national conversation around mass incarceration and prosecutor integrity. In 2017, Fast Company listed Ty on their list of the most creative people, and Billboard named her as one of the most powerful women in music and entertainment. Ty earned her MBA from the Wharton School and got her undergrad from the University of Pennsylvania. She serves on several private and nonprofit boards. Like I said, I've really admired Ty for a long time, and I'm just so glad that she's here tonight. Please welcome Ty Stichlorius.
Thank you.
Hi.
That was so nice.
Oh, welcome.
Thank
it's great
you
to
so
have
much.
You here.
I want to take your class. Like, I wish I could have gone on that trip, seen Kobe Bryant. And this is like the coolest place ever. Do you guys know how lucky you are? Man, I miss it. I miss school.
It's good to have you back, or good to have you here. Is this your first time at SC?
No, I've been on the campus a couple times before. Yeah.
If you haven't been here in like 2 years, there's like 20 new buildings and new programs, and it's some place is sort of on fire right now.
Yeah, it's innovating.
It's a good place to be. You know, I told you when we talked on the phone, this class is primarily about mindset and philosophy more than skill set. So I think this would be a great thing to sort of dive into your approach and philosophy, your background, your narrative, all those things we sort of like to cover. But let's start with something fun. Mm-hmm. Where will you be on April 1st?
Ah, good question. I'm going to be in New York, in Brooklyn, actually. It's Easter Sunday, and I'm exec producing the live for NBC version of Jesus Christ Superstar. And John Legend is playing the role of Jesus. So if you guys are home for the holidays and you have nothing to do, tune in to NBC, 8 p.m. John Legend will be the Black Jesus, which we're so excited about. Sarah Bareilles is playing the part of Mary Magdalene. We've basically been living out our theater geek dreams, because when I met John, we went to Penn together, and we were both in theater and a cappella, and that's how we became friends. So now we get to like be at rehearsals for weeks at a time, and hopefully it's going to be great, and we're going to win the Emmy. And then if we win the Emmy, John will have an EGOT.
So anyone know what an EGOT is?
Emmy, Grammy, Oscar, and Tony. So we have all the other ones, we just don't have the Emmy. And only 13 people have it in like the world. So it's like us and Lin-Manuel like gunning for it at the same time.
It's sort of sneaking in the back door of an Emmy, because it's actually closer to a Tony,
kind of like
what
a Tony.
You're doing.
I know.
But he already has a Tony for.
He has a Tony for a production of August Wilson's play in New York City that happened last year. And so we just got lucky to be part of like the last production of any August Wilson play that hadn't happened. And we won the Tony this past year, and we're hoping to bring it back around to Broadway too.
That's great.
Yeah.
It's so interesting to work with, you know, a diversified roster of clients, but even within an individual, you know, to see such sort of talent across all mediums.
Yeah,
well,
you know,
fun for you.
Back when I started in the music business, or, you know, everybody was sort of like, you had to pick a lane. Like, you couldn't be a musician and an actor and a Tony Award winner and a producer and a social impact warrior. Like, you had to sort of just focus on this one. And everybody told us that, and we just didn't listen. You know, everybody was like, look, if, you know, John really wants to make it, he better just be a musician. And because that's what the labels are incentivized towards, and like, everybody in power really wants the artist to just be like that one thing. And I don't know if it's because John is just like the smartest, most interesting, kind, ambitious human being I know, and because he had the trust with me from like a lifetime together, that we just were like, we're gonna do it differently. We're gonna try different things and not be afraid of failing and not be afraid of, you know, maybe like being less relevant on the music side. But the irony is it's like the longer his career has gone, he's gotten even more and more relevant. And now we're doing that with artists like Lindsey Stirling, who outsells John Legend in terms of like albums and ticket sales around the world. She has 10 million YouTube subscribers. And everybody slammed the door in her face when she tried to start this like 5 years ago. And now I think she's one of the most like talented, profitable. She owns it all. She never signed to a label or a publishing company. Like, she is a YouTube star, a violinist, and a dancer who has had the number one selling dance album on the Billboard charts for the last like 3 years in a row, had the number one selling new Christmas album of this past holiday. She beat Sia and Gwen Stefani. And you know, none of it makes any sense. Like, and it doesn't follow the old paradigm of like how there were gatekeepers that would like elevate a certain kind of thing. Now you can really like be as creative as you want to be, go as broad with your skill set as you want to, and just kind of live more of that creative dream, which is to like not get tired or have to repeat yourself, but actually expand and feel inspired all the time.
Well, the old paradigms, especially in music, are gone.
Yeah.
You know, the idea of signing a big record deal. And
some are still holding
they
on.
They are for dear life, you know, and a couple people get record deals. John, you know, is one of the few, but, you know, friends in jazz, their entire thing has changed. They record a song, they record an album solely to have something to tour with and play,
right,
and new material, but they're not looking to make any money on their albums at all. So, you know, the idea that you were going to not follow the old rules was probably the best thing you did, because the old rules don't work anymore. They don't even apply. I want to dive into, you know, I don't want to shift far forward to Artists at Work before covering a little bit of your background and giving them context, because it's an entrepreneurial class. There's some aspiring entrepreneurs, and, you know, we don't want to give anyone the impression that, you know, the day that I graduated, I launched my first billion-dollar company. You know, that's the exception,
no,
not the rule.
I graduated into that era where, like, you know, September 11th had happened. Like, the whole world was just the country. There were no jobs. It was like we were with the Wharton kids that graduated from like business school, ready to take on the world, and there were so few jobs. I mean, everybody was so afraid. Like, are we going to be able to pay back our loans? And you know, because the world changed overnight after September, you know, that really affected a lot of the job market. We went into a recession. So, yeah, it was not pretty. I did not get here right away.
Yeah, it's also a good point, is to make sure you observe your circumstances and the macro condition of the economy, because right now you guys are really lucky. Like, you know, you can go raise $500,000 on an average idea. Like, it's a good time to raise money. There's plenty of capital if that's what you need for your business. You know, in 2001 or in 2008, you know what graduates from the best schools did? They got jobs, because that's the only thing that was available at the time.
We became consultants.
Yeah, told
we went
people.
Into like iBanking and consulting at, you know, PowerPoint slides and spreadsheets, which I'm glad I did, because I actually kind of felt like the 2 years of business school was not enough for me to kind of like get super strategic and smart about a lot of. So I focused on media and entertainment because I knew I was like an artist and a creative.
No, we'll jump around. So let's start where you grew up and your family. So where did you grow up? How big was your family? What'd your parents do for work?
Yep. I grew up in the city of Philadelphia. In the city. I was a latchkey kid with an immigrant dad who had sort of fled war-torn Baltic states to come to America when he was a kid. And I was definitely that like first gen. My dad was like, the American dream, like, you know, so you've got to live up to it. And my mom was just a nurse from South Jersey. They met in college and were divorced by the time I was a teenager. So I was a pretty independent kid and like sang in every band I could be in and was in the music scene in Philly that was happening at the time. It was like Questlove and the Roots and Jill Scott and Jazzy Fat Nasties and all these great bands, but nobody was famous. Like, nobody knew who the Roots were. It was just like local bands and we all jammed together.
This is this you? Wait, go to the her jamming.
Oh,
next slide.
Well, that's a little young.
but go back.
That's so funny.
We stole those offline, obviously.
Yeah, look at that.
There's a whole history of you. So you grew up musically. You played piano as a kid?
Piano, guitar, but mostly I was a singer. Right. I loved to sing and had a deep alto voice.
Is that right?
Yeah.
You're the alto in the barbershop quartet?
Exactly. It was called Triple Trio.
I was too. I was like this
big. Ever sing? Can I beat that other guy who wants to be the top five if I sing a song?
Do you think that's going to do it?
I've seen him speak before. He is amazing, actually. He spoke at like the SpaceX XPRIZE things that I've been to, the Singularity University.
Yeah.
And he teaches you all these tricks about how to like remember names and stuff. So definitely come back for that. He's going to be better than me.
That's not true. That's not true. So growing up, you had a brother?
Yeah, older brother, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So the youngest of two. And what type of schools did you go to? And how did that sort of form the basis of sort of your aspect on service and how we're connected to each other?
So when my dad immigrated to the United States and lived in Philadelphia, he was at a public school in West Philly, and the Quaker schools in Philadelphia, if anybody knows what the Quaker schools are, the Friends schools, they're very like progressive, great education, private education. They came to my dad's school and did IQ tests on all the seventh graders, and my dad, I guess, got a good score, even though he couldn't really speak English. They brought him to Friends Central. And that's where I ended up going to school, because my dad was like, that school gave him everything he needed to be a success in life, even though he absolutely hated it, because he was like this poor kid who was just teased all the time and just didn't fit in. So it's funny, like, because I knew he was like traumatized by the school he made me go to, but we had changed by the time. I mean, back then he had to like clean the cafeteria in order to like go to the school. He had to like, I've seen the letters from the principal back then. He was like late to clean the cafeteria one morning and they were threatening to kick him out. Like it was very interesting what we used to do for scholarships. Yeah. But when I went to Friends Central, it was this like super progressive, open-minded, like the whole child, and they, you know, expressing our creativity and our entrepreneurship was like woven into what we do, in addition to being graded on concern for the community. So from like first through 12th grade, we were graded on how much we cared about each other and collaborated. We had to work in the community. So I worked at battered women and children's centers. I worked with autistic kids when that was like a relatively new diagnosis. Like I was constantly out in the world doing things to solve problems. And that was part of the ethos of the school. Social impact is like, people always ask like, why did you combine that? Why do you care about that? You know, like I'm a manager. I don't use that word, but I am John Legend's and Lindsay Sterling's and Alanis Morissette's manager. So if you guys know, Scooter Braun is Justin Bieber's manager and Guy Osiri is Madonna's manager. It's like a funny term because it sounds so patronizing. I think it's sort of old school. Like I don't manage John Legend. He's the smartest guy I know. We're partners. But technically in the music business and everywhere else, people are like, oh yeah, that's John's manager, and that's what he calls me. But people, like when I went out on my own, people were like, why do you, like Guy Osiri was like, what are you doing? Like that philanthropy thing, like do that over here. Like that makes no sense to combine that with what you're doing. And I was like, yeah, I don't know. Like I really get uninspired about just launching another pop hit. Like I this is in my bones. Like I want to build a 100,000 square foot place in South LA, and Issa Rae is going to be there, and we're going to have studios. We're going to do all this cool shit and give jobs to the community. And he was just like, you're insane. And now it's a thing. Like I met my friend Molly the other day at the Makers Conference, and Molly's like, I just got a job. I was like, what are you doing, Molly? She's like, Guy Osiri hired me to run social impact division of his company, of Mavericks. So I was like, yes, it's working. Like it's now in the zeitgeist that companies and entrepreneurs and everybody should be like, you know, socially responsible and care about the community. So growing up, that was just part of what I learned and what I did. And it was a habit. We practiced concern for the community. And I'm really glad that that was woven into my existence and my education, because it kind of never left me. And when I got to Penn, you know, John Legend was that he was John Stevens, really small little guy with small, you know, round glasses. He had come in from Springfield, Ohio. He'd never really been on a plane. He was such a fish out of water. And I was like the big Philly kid who knew the city. And he applied, he tried out for this jazz and blues a cappella group that I was the president of, and he had the best voice I'd ever heard. And he got in, of course, and became the music director. So we ran it like a business from the time he was 16 and I was 18.
What was it called? Yeah.
Counterparts.
Do you have a picture of Counterparts?
Yeah, I saw that up there. We were such nerds, oh my God. We really were. My husband still makes so much fun of me, like the a cappella thing. Does anybody do that? It's pretty nerdy. Okay.
No,
good.
Last year we had like three members who were music majors and sang a cappella, beatbox and everything.
Yeah.
But worked out pretty well for you.
Yeah. I'm it was actually beyond just getting to meet John and know John. I really loved it because it was like we all had a shared interest that had nothing to do with like whether you reminded me of my friend growing up. Like there was no similarity really other than the fact that we all could sing well. And so it was the most diverse group where I got to know people and collaborate with people that weren't just easy to get to know. You know, a lot of people join like sororities or they join clubs. Like this was a really cool, and most of my best friends came out of it. And when I got to business school, I don't know if you guys do this, but we were graded entirely for 2 years at Wharton on collaboration and teams. We didn't have any individual grades really. So in some of my teams at Wharton, you know, there were like students there from all parts of the world and like some guys that were a little bit like misogynist for my taste. And I was just like, shit, I got to get along with this guy. And you did because you were graded on it. So it taught you how to like collaborate and get along and like bridge divides even when you didn't necessarily naturally feel like, man, I can really work with you, you know?
So good lesson. You never know who your classmates are and will become, particularly at a school like Penn or USC. So be active, be interested, be social, because some of those relationships may change your life.
Yeah.
In a lot of different ways. So you graduate from Penn. What'd you major in?
English and economics.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what'd you do after school? What work did you do?
So because of this, I worked in the Northern Empowerment Zone of Philadelphia, which was designated by the federal government as like one of the most violent, crime-ridden, drug-infested, abandoned parts of the country. And the government designated these places around the United States as empowerment zones to try to spur like business and development. And this one very brilliant entrepreneur named Charlie Zarotti decided to buy up a whole block of this in the middle of North Philly, like this abandoned area. There was nothing there but like old abandoned warehouses and a giant field. I mean, you could park your car askew and shoot up at the sky and no one would know. There was one Chinese food restaurant with bulletproof glass. We ate there every day. But anyway, we took over this whole block and we created like the first, it was called Monsoon Micro Studios, and we were doing like websites for companies when nobody had websites. We were doing exactly what you just did on your trip.
In Myanmar.
But like for local Philadelphia businesses. We did Wu-Tang Clan music videos. We shot commercials. We were just this creative hub, but mostly kind of like groundbreaking in the new digital stuff. And this was back in 1997. So like .com sites were brand spanking new. Like if you had a .com site, you were like. And so I worked there as like the only woman in this group of like ragtag entrepreneurs and artists, basically. And Shepard Ferry, you know, who did the Hope poster, like he was a local artist and painted the entire inside of our building with all the Andre the Giants before anybody knew who he was, you know, I mean. It was just a really cool place to be and just constantly like innovating. And so I was like, I don't know, I'll help and I'll be the senior account executive. And I think I made like $25,000 a year and I loved it. I loved every second of it.
How long did you do that? And so what was the time period between undergrad and grad school?
Yeah, so I did that for 3 years and then I left with one of my clients. It was a company called Gbox that was a music notation software company. So we were building their website and doing all stuff for them, and then they decided to hire me. And that's when I got into like a more well-funded tech world. I mean, like they had funding from all the big guys in New York. And we had MIT, polyphonic voice recognition, all this groundbreaking technology. We created this machinery that would connect to your guitar, so you could like strum on your guitar and it would notate everything for you and you could play it back. And it was so cool, and I was a musician and in local bands, and So that entire sort of, I mean, I went from like 25K to like 75. Like I was like, yes, I'm like totally gonna like rule the tech world. And at that point, I think I was 25, 26, and we were all gonna be billionaires by the time we were 30. Like dot-com world was taking off. About.com would have parties, we'd go, like, yeah, you know, Lycos. Like I'm trying to think of all those early.
They don't even know what it is.
You guys don't know what I'm talking about, but like super early, like the world was our oyster and like nothing was gonna go wrong. And then the whole bubble burst. And like our company lost all its funding, and so did every other .com company except for like a few, right? Remember that?
Yeah. 2000.
You started to see it in 99, 2000, and then by 2001 it was like done. And so as my backup plan, I was either going to go to India to teach English and backpack around the world. But my immigrant dad was like, absolutely no, like you need to get a business degree. You're never gonna make it in America if you don't understand all this stuff, which is why I did the econ. I was like, Dad, I'm an English major. And he's like, you gotta do econ. But it's good, because my natural, like I wanted to be an artist, and my dad insisted on me understanding business. And so I applied to Wharton because it was the one in my backyard, and I had gone to Penn. And
you
I thought
you never left your hometown.
I stayed in Philly till I was 28. And I got into Wharton, which I couldn't believe because my GMAT scores were actually not that good. I mean, they were fine, right, but they weren't great. And Wharton's really hard to get into. And I got in and my dad cried and I was like crying too, but because I think I wanted to go to India. But I went to Wharton kicking and screaming, and it was great for my confidence and my sense of self and like my knowledge of the world and my back macro picture of how things work. It was just scraping the surface, but it definitely woke me up. And then I had a summer internship in Seattle at Real Networks, which was like a tech company that was still doing well. And I had never been to Seattle. And I got to go live in this other place and like see this whole other world. And then after Wharton, I moved back to Seattle and then to LA and just kind of never left the West Coast and stayed in entertainment and media and it all. I mean, it wasn't easy at first. You want me to go into that? The trauma of like post-graduate school years.
Yes, I do want to go into that. We love trauma in this class. We love to dive in.
Well,
what were you noticing? What were you experiencing?
Yeah.
You were in tech, you were in entertainment, you were in media, and sort of, and that was 2000.
Yeah. It was 2003, 2004. Okay. So I graduated Wharton in 2003. So like 2003 to 2004, 2005, I was consulting. I was doing like, I worked at a place called LEK, which is a global consulting firm, but my boss was Kevin Mayer. Do you guys know Kevin Mayer? He's the head of strat planning and business development at Disney now. He's Iger's right hand, and he's been at Disney for almost 10 years, but he's widely credited for like the acquisitions of Lucasfilms and Marvel. Like he's one of the smartest media entertainment executives on the planet. You need to have him here. He's so good.
With your introduction, we will.
But when I worked for him, he was like a partner at LEK. And I did not love, you know, the rigor of consulting. We were there every night till 1 or 2 in the morning. You know, you'd make slide decks like 100 slides in, and then they'd be thrown out because something wasn't relevant anymore. But it was, again, it felt like, you know, business school and then consulting felt kind of like years of just like practice. It wasn't my passion, but I got good at a certain way of thinking. And I think it really did, and it has helped me when I kind of took the, so I did the consulting thing. I did everything I was supposed to do after business school. And I was, at that point, I was making like 250, you know, it was great. Like I was finally there. Which is what John Legend did after Penn. He went to BCG Consulting.
Yeah. And, what a just.
Yeah,
well,
I know.
We don't need another consultant. We need more, you know, poets and songwriters. And
yeah, well, BCG was a good gig if you could get it. And only the smartest and most creative kids got the jobs at BCG. So John Legend was like 3 years there, 4 years there. And I remember when he decided to leave because he wanted to go for his music. And he was like, I'm gonna take a leap and invest in my music and my career and my artistry. And I was like, you're crazy. Like, what are you? And my dad was like speaking through, like, do you know how few people make it in music? And I'm going back to Wharton, so I'm gonna be the smart one. And then he made it. And we were all like, oh my God, you actually did it. Like the one in a 20 million or whatever. But I was in consulting, and then I worked at a company called Ascent Media for a woman named Sarah Harden, who was my first and only woman boss, and she was amazing.
It is.
And now, you know who she is?
Yeah, Sarah. She spoke at our Scale conference. She's now the CEO of Hello Sunshine with Reese Witherspoon and a friend. I actually wrote you an email after we got off the phone.
Oh, wow.
That said, you should know the people at Hello Sunshine.
Oh, no way. I was just with her 2 days ago because we're trying to do like a Lindsay Sterling podcast through Hello Sunshine.
That's the fit right there.
Yeah. So Sarah was my boss at Ascent. And then I worked for the CFO of Ascent Media and was, again, doing like PowerPoints and spreadsheets and five-year plans and all this stuff that I was like I'd gotten really good at. But I was just not inspired by. And the big public company that I was in, it would sort of like, we would come up with all these cool, inspiring, innovative plans, but then quarterly results would need to happen, so they'd slash and burn all of the innovative stuff, and like we'd be left with no budgets just to be able to reduce costs to make the right quarterly results for the public. So I was like, I don't wanna work at public companies. I didn't wanna have like all that like lack of control. And like that Kafka feeling of like the note comes down from the top floor and you don't know, and then everything you worked on just disappears because of quarterly results and the need to cut costs. And so, but I nobody leaves those jobs. Like, why would you leave that job? So the only reason that I ever went to go start working for John Legend was because I was at Ascent Media and I took a flight home after Christmas Day from Seattle. And I'm 27,000 feet looking over Mount Rainier, and there's snow, and I had a cold. And all of a sudden, in the plane, you heard a loud pop, like an explosion. And wind was rushing through the plane, and the mass came down, and there was chaos, and started to, I mean, it was, this is how it ends. Like, never experienced anything like it. Ended up being all over the news. There was a big lawsuit. Alaska Airlines had fired the labor union workers, and so they hired these temporary workers, and one of the baggage handlers had hit the plane with the baggage truck and hadn't reported it, and planes are really fragile. So we got up to 27,000 feet, and the fuselage, just a 3-foot hole opened up in the plane. Did I ever tell you this story?
No.
Yeah, sorry.
It's gripping.
So yeah, I had some combination of like praying to my grandma and like promising to, if we landed and survived, like if this was a parallel universe and I could go either way, like I wanted to make sure that I lived every moment like vitally and did what I was supposed to do. And I kind of had been sort of maybe not depressed, but like not doing what I was supposed to do. I remember knowing that like my back wasn't healthy because I was like up all night doing this kind of thing. So we had emergency landing and everybody was fine. And I went in and quit my job that week. And then I spent like a few months just soul searching and trying to figure out what I wanted to do. And my good friend John Legend had just put his album out and was kind of doing well. And he was in New York, I was living in LA, and he was like, why don't you come east and we'll just spend 2 days whiteboarding, like I need your brain on how and what my career could be. And so we got together in the Meatpacking District in New York in 2005, early 2006, and we mapped out like everything he would ever want to be or anything we could do together. And it included like Time Magazine 100 Most Influential, own a film and TV production company, get an EGOT, you know, like all the things we wanted to be, solve a massive problem, let's fix education reform, let's also like make sure we're not the most incarcerated country in the world. And you know, we were just these cocky 28-something-year-old, like, business kid, you know, and we just thought we knew everything and we could do everything. And John had a traditional manager who was good at, like, music and probably like radio and touring, but he was, you know, his BCG sort of background, he was like, I want to own the value chain, man. Like, I want to own, you know, I want to do it all. And I don't trust the sort of traditional music managers to do that. Why don't I hire you and we can do this together? So he hired me. I was really lucky, but I did take a pay cut. But I moved to New York and we started John Legend Ventures. And then within a year, he was like, I don't want to stay with my management. Like, why don't we go look for something better? And so I was worried that I didn't know how to be a manager for him, like, because I didn't want to ruin my best friend's career. So I was like, why don't I team up with like a big guy and I'll learn the ropes and I'll be your inside person, like protecting you and doing everything, and we'll build this together, but we'll have like a well-known manager sort of teach us the ropes. And that's how I got into it.
So who did you, how did your father feel about leaving the safety of a corporate job and going to work?
He was, I think at that point he was pretty concerned, like that this was a big entrepreneurial leap and that it wasn't anything near like a sure thing. You know, my dad would have been comfortable if I was like a lawyer or, you know, an accountant or something like where it was steady. So he was a little nervous, but I think he also kind of by that point knew enough about me that like, I think he saw the skill in me that was the entrepreneur, that was the passionate kind of like creative person that I was, and he started to support me more in that. But for years, like nobody in my family understood what I did. And then John started getting like more and more famous, and they had seen him at a cappella concerts in college, so like they knew this was my friend. But all of a sudden they started to like see John on the Grammys or whatever, and they were like, oh my God, this is working, you know?
Yeah. It must be surreal to like look at your daughter's friend who started out with glasses and 16 years old in college, and you know, 9 Grammys later and all the 10, sorry.
Don't you take away one of my.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It was 9 when he played our concert. But it must be surreal for them to see that. And you know, those things don't happen without you. You guys truly are a team. What are some of the highlights that you've experienced with him over the course of your, and we'll get into the social impact, but just share with us some of the, like the phone home moments.
Oh man, there's been so many. I mean, I can't think of a room that we didn't get into. I'll say 2 that will forever be highlights of my life. One was a party at the White House, where like, I swear we were in like the West Wing, DJ Nice was DJing, the entire room was filled with like friends, like Dave Chappelle dancing to my left, the Roots to my right, like friends that we had grown up with from Philly forever. And it might have been like midnight or 1 in the morning and the party was still going. And this is at the White House, right? So like there's a giant painting of like Washington looking down on all of us and another one of like, it just, was so surreal. I actually was crying. It was so beautiful and amazing. And at one point, DJ Nice starts playing, like, started from the bottom, now we're here. And President Obama came in. And he started dancing. And we were all just like, I can't even describe it. Janelle Monáe, everybody, we were all there. And I was like, how did I get here? Ta-Nehisi Coates was there. When Ta-Nehisi Coates was writing the book, We Were 8 Years in Power, he called to fact check stuff that like the Dave Chappelle moment at the top of the book, I don't know if any of you read it, but we were all kind of stuck outside to try to get in. And Dave Chappelle was just like cracking all these jokes. And so Ta-Nehisi called me to be like, is that what he said? Because I want to fact check it because I'm putting it in my book. And I was like, I think, yep, I was there. So that was a pinch me moment. And then the Nobel Peace Prize this past year in Oslo, Norway, John performed at the Nobel Peace Prize, and we just spent a few days in Norway and got to sit with the whole committee and learn the process and meet like the king and queen, and then just to watch that concert and to meet the people that won the prize was pretty mind-blowing. And but the thing about the Nobel Peace Prize is interesting, and if any of you young entrepreneurs want to take this on, please do, because it's like this widely known and recognized brand. Like, who knows the Nobel Peace Prize? like everyone, right? And I'll bet where you were, people still know about it. Sure. But I'll bet you don't know who won this past year. Does anybody know who won?
In what category?
In the Nobel Peace Prize.
Like, oh,
there's
Peace Prize, yeah.
There's the Nobel Prizes, but the Peace Prize is uniquely in Norway. Does anybody know who won? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it was an anti, it was a group called ICAN that won, and they're an anti-nuclear proliferation group all over the world. But the Nobel Peace Prize is like this amazing global brand that does such a poor job storytelling, connecting with young people. If you go to their Twitter feed, there's 1,000 followers. Like, there's nobody's transitioned these amazing brands into like this modern era. They don't understand that what the TED Talk has been able. They didn't even know what TED was, which was mind blowing to me. And so it's this like interesting sort of isolated, you know, but very important group that I think needs some like refreshing so that young people can actually know about it enough to care and think that one day like one of you could win a Nobel Peace Prize. Because so we may end up working with them, but we'll see.
That would be a good client.
It would be, yeah.
And you're right, you know, it sort of comes and goes quickly, and so did Malala won it a few years ago, and the new president or the
Aung San Suu Kyi
from Myanmar,
and they just took it away from her.
Yes, who took it away from her? Like, so that was a couple years ago.
Did you know? Like, I was just with a bunch of tech leaders in this gathering called the Powwow, and have you guys heard of Tristan, who started the Center for Humane Technology? Does anybody know that? And this is like a side note, but I have to tell you guys this because when you were talking about Burmese language stuff, he's talking about like how we're all so addicted to tech and how all these tech companies have this monumental influence, right? Like monumental. Obviously, we've just seen it with like the Cambridge Analytica thing through Facebook. So YouTube started a Burmese language YouTube, and all of this Burmese language video was being uploaded. And because it's algorithmic and it's sort of like constantly putting like the most popular videos in front of you, nobody was watching, but it was putting all this anti-Rohingya video in front of anybody who was pulling up wanting to watch or watching any kind of Burmese language video. So for a long time, this technology was unchecked, posting this sort of like genocidal propaganda. And no one really noticed. And people, you know, there's an argument to be made that YouTube was like leading to like a genocide, like contributing.
Yeah, like the radio did in Rwanda in 96.
And so we spent a lot of time talking about like entrepreneurs like Travis Kalanick and, you know, anybody who's started something that they can't quite contain, and what do you do when like your bottom line metric is about getting someone's attention? Well, what's the biggest competitor to our attention? It could either be like, well, Facebook might say, well, it's Twitter. But the bigger than Twitter is our sleep. Sleep. That's like, that takes your most attention away from any of these. So now they want to like chip away at that. And this is like a room of all the tech leaders, like the founder of Stripe and, you know, Facebook senior executives and all these people like debating what kind of role and ethical sort of responsibility do these companies have. And so I remember when I was at Wharton, we had like one ethics class, but we didn't really talk about like if you're going to go become an entrepreneur and make billions of dollars and like become one of the unicorns and go change the frickin' world. Like, it's great, but like you better be careful. Like the monumental amount of responsibility and impact that so many of these entrepreneurs that like we worshipped for a while, like I feel like business schools need to completely change the, I don't know how much you guys address that at these schools, but it's like, I think it's incredibly important that we watch that we're not just letting these companies sort of get away with selling our data to Cambridge Analytica, not selling it, but letting it leak to it, or having anti-Rohingya videos propagated on YouTube, or or that we're all losing sleep and we're getting addicted to these things. Like, there's all sorts of anxieties and depression, and suicide is now the number one killer of adolescents. And so, like, who's responsible for all that? And as entrepreneurs, like, if you start these things or you go work for these companies, you have to be mindful that your number one priority is the betterment of the planet, not to make it worse. And I remember being at Wharton and all these people being like, I got a job at, you know, this company, I'm gonna sell more Oreos and we're gonna like make the Oreos smaller and then people can like pour them down their throat with a cup from the, and I was like, oh my God, you're proud of that? I'm like, not, so I'm sorry if any of you are gonna go take a job at P&G, it's probably a good training or whatever, but like, take a job that like really fucking makes a difference and matters and like helps people, not makes them fat, you know? But that's just me, and I can stand on this soapbox all day long.
I do think about that now, like what, and you're right, some of these brands and companies, they're great training. That's where you go to get trained, and they'll pay you good money, and you'll learn how to do things right, you'll learn how to do things wrong. But I was just thinking, I'll edit this out.
Just like, none of this is going up online.
Just like, imagine like your whole life is selling like something that you know is bad for people. You know, like sugary drinks, like
guns. Sorry.
Let's go to the, you know, most obvious. It's just like, that's your life. And so, you know, what do you do when you like look at your body of work and you're like, wow, I increased profits for a company that was so bad for people's lives.
Yeah. Philip Morris. I mean, like, and there's a lot of executives that you should have one of those people that's like regretted their entire freaking career so that they can like scare you so that none of you do that, you know? Like, do not take a job or start a company that is bad. Just don't do it. And even if you're Google and you're like, we're the good guys, and what was there, do no harm,
do no harm.
Or something. Like, even
do no evil or something.
Yeah. Even that, I'm not sure is enough of a commitment. Like,
yeah, that's the negative of not doing good, of do no harm.
Yeah,
don't be really, really offensive.
Yeah, don't be.
Don't kill people.
Just don't be evil.
But you can make them sick and addicted for a long time. It's so you can see where like your schooling and your adolescence sort of was, as you said, woven into the fabric of who you are, and you had the courage to bake that into your company. And as people said, you're crazy. You know, like those always when you have good ideas, by the way, when people say you're crazy.
Right.
But that's not what makes you unique, I think. Well, other people are copying, but you formed it in your own sort of values. You built a culture. And is that sort of what made it different than other management companies, even though it's a broader platform than that?
Yeah, I mean, I left to really big. I was the co-president of one of the biggest management companies, Atom Factory. Troy Carter had founded it. He was Lady Gaga's manager. They were also like tech entrepreneurs and investors. Now Troy is like one of the heads at Spotify. Really great, very smart, one of the better entrepreneurs in the world. In fact, he was even on Shark Tank for a while, right?
He was a guest shark.
Has he come to the con?
Yeah, he came a couple
years
ago.
He's great. Yeah. And I learned a lot under him, but I also kind of knew in every one of these environments that I had a different perspective on how I wanted to launch a company and how I wanted to lead it and what type of transparency I wanted and what type of incentives I wanted. Because a lot of these guys had not been to business school and had not worked in big professional environments, and so they were sort of running it by the old music hustler model. And I was kind of like, I feel like we could do something like better that can lift up a younger generation and not have tons of turnover and like do something that's better for the artists and do something where like my clients won't leave me after 3 or 4 years and like really go the distance. And it took, I mean, I like nights and nights and nights of worry and like not being able to eat every time I left to try something better. Like, it's not easy to try to launch your own company, and it's not easy to even leave a company. I don't know, maybe it's easier now, but it's always been hard for me because it's change, and change is hard, and you don't know whether you're going to make it. And it's easier to blame someone at the top and just like, you know, complain and be like, do what you do. But leaving and starting my own company was out of necessity because I was always going to be unhappy under someone else. And I knew I had a different model that I wanted to, but actually doing it has been one of the most rewarding and one of the hardest things I've ever done in my life. It's partly why I haven't seen you in like a few years, because it's like having, I have two kids, and that was hard, you know, raising babies. They're 7 and 9, so it's, but launching a company is like having triplets. I don't know. It's just around the clock, and it tugs and pulls on your emotions in interesting ways. And like, I didn't realize that, like, in addition, when you start a company, you should have like, you should go through like a health and wellness training program too. Like, you should definitely get a therapist, because starting a company is, it's a huge responsibility. The cash flow, I mean, we only have like 20 employees, but it's still like, it's 20 people's livelihood, and I care about them living their best lives. Like, I don't have employees that I'm just like, you know, I just think of everybody as part of a family. The company is called Friends at Work. I want everybody, including all of our artist partners and our clients, like Katie Coleman, who's an astronaut, who's one of our clients, like all these people we love, I want everybody to elevate. And so, yeah, I'm learning. I think I'm still like an entrepreneur in training in a way.
Well, it, first of all, it never gets easy. It may get more stable, but it never gets easy, particularly if you're growing. But you mentioned how you want people in your company to be their best selves. Mm-hmm. So I want to talk about culture for a minute. How many people were in Monday's class with Pete Carroll? Okay, good. So you're also a Seattle fan?
From Seattle.
So Pete talked about, you know, sort of how to build a high performance culture. And he invests so much time in not just training the coaches, but the idea is that we want to invest in you relationship-based coaching so that you're your best on and off the field. Not just so how can you make me better and a better coach and win-loss record, but and that is an immense commitment. Mm-hmm. Particularly with, you said 30 people or 20 people?
About 20.
It doesn't matter. Like 20 people that you're trying to coach up and understand their lives and be connected to, and obviously the people underneath you are doing that as well. Is that your culture there, and how do you sort of implement that?
Yeah, it is. I mean, in some ways it'll always be aspirational to name yourself John Legend, and it'll always be aspirational to name your company Friends at Work. You know, I mean, we are aiming to be like an entertainment, social impact, and management company that where we get to practice what we're hoping our artists and our partners will do. Like, if we're not living in a healthy, responsible, high integrity way, I'm not sure we can advise Alanis Morissette, you know, while we're like doing all the wrong things. And then we represent those people. So like, I'm sure all of you, well, maybe not, I don't know if even any of you know about or care about John Legend. His audience is a bit older, but he's a really high integrity person. So like, if I'm caught or representing something, or my company, it's like it's a lot of responsibility when you have celebrities and people like of that stature. And I've had so many acts come to me, and they're like, I didn't know my manager was like a dick and like doing all sorts of awful shit for the last year, and that was hurting our career. That no one wanted to deal with him, that he was just a jerk of a negotiator or whatever it was. And so if you have a team that's representing you, and we're not, you know, doing the right, like representing, I think it could really harm a lot of creativity, a lot of these people's lives and stuff like that. So yeah, it's a culture that I take very, very seriously of all of us, and I need to walk the walk. Like, I wake up in the morning and meditate, and I post photos of my kids because I want people to spend time with, I want John Legend to spend time and be a father and be present. I want us all to like talk through these things that help us live our better lives. And it's not always easy, but for the most part, we're having a lot of fun. Like, we really are enjoying it, and we're building like the company of our dreams. And you know, it's like we love going to work, and we stay there, and then we love like hanging out with each other and doing offsites, and we love killing it for our clients. Like, we have a single release coming up in about 2 weeks, and I think every day we have a video. Oh yeah, watch what we are.
What's the video? Oh cool.
Hey, Sarah, help me pull
Can
it
you
up.
Can you turn down the lights a little bit? Or a lot?
Came here with my cool, I lost it. Came with my cool, I dropped it.
If I'm being honest, I'm being honest. I can't think when you're looking like that. Can't breathe when you're moving like that. Tell me when you're gonna do me like that. Yeah, I'm so weak and I'm never like that. Like speed and I think I might crash. One trip, damn, I'ma never go back. But everything's gonna be alright. I think I just met my wife. Yeah, I said it. I know it's gonna be a good night. I think I just met my wife. Alright. Maybe it's the music or the red stain on your lips. I'm wondering when the right time is to go in for a kiss. I'm thinking past that love. I'm ready to meet your mom.
Cause love's just a feeling. Wish I could get a little drunk so I could uncall you at 5 in the morning. I would unfuck you, but some things you cannot do. I wish I could unkiss this room full of strangers so I could unspot you. I lose my temper, but some things you cannot do. All you want is a stronger man, but I can't play. And they told me lies. Why am I surprised? I'm no superman.
It's all about love. Too much. Yeah, maybe that's because everybody's lonely.
Please welcome Diana Gordon.
Wanna come home cause you miss out on Kool-Aid. Don't you wanna come home? One of these days you'll be missing.
That is so good, and I need to get out more. I don't know all those, but
no,
congratulations.
Most people don't, but if we do our job right, more people will know.
It's so good. I mean, just think of that. Like, you're in the dream business, and to like help people like realize things beyond even what they can imagine. You know, you guys whiteboarded some pretty audacious things, and like you're like exceeding even those wildest dreams. So what a great life for you, for your clients. You mentioned that you wanted to share some of the lessons. You talked with the Obama team recently.
Yeah.
And I wanted to sort of, before I open up for questions for them, I wanted you to share sort of what you learned.
Well, I guess, I don't know, how many of you consider yourself like activists in any type of way? Okay, that's good. That's like half the class. I was just with David Seamus, who's like the CEO of the Obama Foundation, and he was talking about, we have some Trump supporters. They're leaving.
No.
I'm kidding.
Let me have another.
Sorry, I didn't mean to single you out. Sorry. But anyway, this is applicable to like all political spectrums. But basically, David Seamus, who's like one of the smartest people on the planet, he's kind of like the Karl Rove. He helped like both elections. He knows he's done so many focus groups about voters and people in this country and how do we unify instead of continuing to divide. And he would say, you need to go from your activism to organizing. And I think this applies to for-profit endeavors as well. And when you become an organizer and they're training like all these young people around the country to organize, they're giving them this sort of like three-part multi-day training. But the three things are, first, in order to be an effective organizer and a change agent, you have to learn how to tell your story. because in order to influence anyone or have any influence, you have to be trusted and known and tell your story. And I don't know, it took me a long time to get comfortable like sharing my story, because for the longest time I was like, nobody wants to know about my story. You know, like my story is my story and it's boring because you lived it. But if you get good at explaining and talking about your story, and it takes practice, but do it, you'll then be able to like meet someone and win them over and have some influence and trust between you because you've shared your story. So that's the first thing they teach these organizing kids. Second, they talk about problem complexity. So if you care about, who raised their hand that they're an activist? Okay. What issue do you care about?
I want to help people become their best selves, like you. So just if there's creativity in school, like the education system starting at a young age,
okay,
implement certain things to, I guess, help every unique child.
Cool. Yeah, because so many kids don't have an access to a quality education, right? So if one of the things you wanted to fix was like, you know, education, one of the things they'll do is teach you to go deeper into the complexity of any problem. So if anybody else was like, poverty is my, I want to end poverty, it's like, okay, you have to map out like days and days of complexity around those problems in order to ever come up with the innovative entrepreneurial way to solve it. So if you locate a problem you want to solve, spend weeks and months and years researching that problem till you understand how complex it is. John and I have been in the education reform space for over a decade, and we're still learning the complexity, and we're still trying to find like the entrepreneurial ways in to like solve it, right? But so first, tell your story. Second, go through the complexity mapping on a particular problem and whatever you want to solve. And third, power mapping. So like, let's say one of you is all about like criminal justice reform, which I hope all of you are, because we're the most incarcerated country in the world, and that's really weird when we're the land of the free. Like, why do we incarcerate 2.2 million people, mostly black and brown? Like, it's a really big issue, and you should all get engaged in it, whether you've ever had anybody go away or not. Like, it's just, that's a problem I'm hoping you will all dive into a little bit more. But if that's an issue you care about, then you need to know who has power, right? So the same thing, education, any other issue. They do power mapping to say, like, okay, the person who probably has the most power in your criminal justice, does anybody know who the district attorney of Los Angeles is? Oh my God! What's wrong with us? Okay, so like the most important person in terms of criminal justice reform is Jackie Lacey. She's the DA. She's run unopposed in this town. She has the biggest criminal justice, like, she has 1,000 prosecutors under her. And she's deciding, and all her prosecutors are deciding every day, who's going away and who's not.
In which cases to prosecute. And
yeah, and whether like that 16-year-old who stole a backpack needs to spend a few years in Rikers waiting trial. So power mapping is about like figuring out who has the power to solve the problem that you're talking about. And those are sort of just three Obama Foundation things that they're teaching a bunch of young organizers. But I think it applies, you know, for any kind of entrepreneurial thing that you're trying to do. Like be able to tell your story, because then you'll probably get VC funding.
Sure.
Be able to, identify the complexity of any issue, and then be able to know who has the power that's going to help you solve it, and get close to those people and tell them your story so that you have influence with them. And I think the greatest entrepreneurs are kind of fluent in all of that, no matter what it is that they're choosing to do.
Absolutely.
Most of the best entrepreneurs that I know have been like entrepreneurs in like 20 different things, and then one of them finally hit. Like I was with the guy who just sold the Ring company for $1 billion. He founded it, he built it. We were on a private jet going to the Yellowstone Club, and he had just sold it to Amazon for $1 billion. And he was going to the Yellowstone Club to sign his name on his new house, his giant house in the Yellowstone Club, you know. Okay. And he had built that, you know, after like 20 other companies that he had tried to make work, but this one succeeded. So you kind of also just kind of get good at like, yeah.
Yeah, no, it applies for anything you're doing. And you talked about the importance of narrative and telling your story. And as a young person, it's sort of a little bit harder because, you know, sort of have a shorter distance to tell and you don't think it's that fascinating.
Yeah.
I want to open up for questions. Before I do, I want to add something lighter and, well, it's fun, maybe not for you, but it was interesting. So being an executive producer of La La Land.
Yes.
Last year.
Yeah. Yes, I was on stage when we won the Oscar. You were on stage
for the craziest moment in Oscar history. Yeah. Take us through that and then we'll open it up to questions for them.
We had won a lot of Oscars that night already, so this was like the final one, Best Picture. And a lot of, actually my high school prom date, David Finkel, had created Moonlight with his company A24. So David, my old friend, was sitting there and I was sort of like, maybe you'll win. And he was like, no, you're probably gonna win. And we, you know, and then they called La La Land and I went up there and was like, Mom, sorry, we won. And we're like up there and John and I are like high-fiving and everybody's so excited. And then all of a sudden it became very clear that something was not right. Something just wasn't right. And we didn't know what it was. And John was like, did we not win? And I was like, I don't think we won. I think there's some mistake. And I was like, we got to get off the stage now. And then all of a sudden there was that reckoning moment where luckily the producer got up there and was like, you know, Moonlight won the Oscar and everybody knew. And it was just this surreal moment. But all I remember is looking down at my high school David Finkel and being like, you won, you won, come up here. And like being so happy that he won. And embarrassed, and also just kind of overwhelmed that like the view of it was like, it's like running with the bulls in Pamplona. Like you're just kind of like right in the middle of it all, like wow. And then we all went backstage and like hugged and cheered and cried, and it was the right, Moonlight should have won. It was the one that needed the Oscar more than La La Land. And we had won so many, and so it actually, you know, it all worked out.
I'm sure Mark Platt feels that way.
Yeah, Mark Platt, a little less happy. But yeah.
Does anyone go to your high school reunion other than you and your friend? Like, who would go if people are up for Best Picture, two people in your high school?
You know what? The guy that runs our film and TV production company, Mike Jackson, he went to my same little Quaker school in Philly. So. Like there's so many creative kids that came out of my school. But actually one of the kids on stage who had just won was the composer of La La Land, and he went to my same school. Jeez. There were 40 kids in my graduating class.
That's a powerhouse school.
It just was like, I think they did the right things to like inspire us to take risks and think out of the box and believe in ourselves and like hone our own voices like at a very young age. And to do the right thing, because honestly, you don't get that far if you're not doing the right thing. If you're like a jerk, if you're a narcissist, if you don't care about people, if you treat people poorly, you know, I don't know, I could be wrong. I guess maybe that whole Facebook movie, I don't know, maybe not everybody. But for the most part, I think like the good guys win. And you don't need to be a jerk along the way.
Not at all. That's a false narrative. Yeah. All right, questions from students. Raise your hand. You got the mic. For Ty, and then I'm going to circle back in the end. And I moment that Ty was involved with.
Hey, thank you for coming. You were saying how it was very hard for you to leave your work and start your own company, and how you kind of left out of necessity. But what made you stick to that goal of like starting your own company and not falling back to corporation, or what was that like mentally, and or what kind of stuff did you do to cope with that?
Thank you, that's a good question. I was 3 years at Adam Factory and my contract was up. So I knew leading up to my contract being up that I had a window of time to make a decision. And I went in to negotiate for myself, because at that point I had signed Megan Trainor, Lindsey Sterling, and I had John Legend. And so I was making the company like over $10 million a year, and it's like mostly all profit. So I went in with my, like, I think the Lean In had just come out, Sheryl Sandberg's book, which talks a lot about how like women need to negotiate for ourselves better. And I brought the book in and I put it down. I was like, I just read this book, you're screwed. I want 50%. and he said no. And so that's when I started like my, like, I'm either gonna stay and be resentful, or I'm gonna go and team up with someone else, or I'm going to go and start my own thing. And honestly, once my contract was up and I did leave, I did take time and was like pursued by a number of other companies to like come and take me, put me under their brand. And I had just done it so many times, I was like, I don't feel like getting married again. You know, I've been divorced twice, not, you know, just with companies, not actually. I've been happily married for a while, 11 years. But I felt like I'd gone through divorces with companies and partners, and so I was like, I want to try to do this on my own for a minute. And I knew I had saved up enough, so I knew I didn't need to take out any money or any partners. I had kind of been preparing for it. And the most important thing was having like the cash flow, the liquidity, and being able to know that if I started it for a year with my team, a lot of my team members came with me, that I could support them, that we would be fine. And I also had clients that I knew were coming with me, and I knew their revenue, and I knew how well they were gonna do. And so like I just knew I could do it financially. I don't think I didn't prep as much for like how psychologically draining it would be, and how much I probably needed to get like a coach along the way. I mean, even though I went to business school and I'd always been a leader and I had teams under me, it's like a different thing when you're the one at the top, because heavy is the head that wears the crown. And I wasn't comfortable with that. Like, I'm good at like collaborating and being Quaker and like sharing, you know, but when I had to make the decisions and own more of the responsibility, it gave me a lot of empathy for the people that had done it before me that I had been under. So I think it took me some time, and I'm 2.5-3 years into this company of running it, and I'm still sort of like, can I do this? Am I okay? You know, it's like a process, actually taking the risk of being the one to have to like.
Thank you.
Hi, hello, thanks for coming. So I wanted to ask you, so you said that the school you come from has ingrained in you the skills to take the risk and explore yourself and do what you excel at. Do you think there's a way other schools in different socioeconomic settings could ingrain the same values in their students as well, so that we could have more individuals come up with these independent skills?
Yeah. John and I spent so much time in the education space, and like, when we realized that in some schools, the kids are more likely to end up in prison than they are in college, like we realized that like we're not giving everybody an opportunity. And I think schools and education needs to change in such a radical way. Like, we have an education system that in a lot of ways is preparing kids for like a 1950s economy where they need to be like a cog in a wheel. And I was just at my own kids' like fundraiser last night, and we're trying to launch an institute for entrepreneurship from middle school to high school. They already launched an institute for STEM, and they want to launch an institute. But this is a private school, so I'm thinking the same thing. Like, how do we give this to kids in other schools? And one of the things John and I launched was something called LRNG Innovators, where we're connecting. Teachers are the most important influencers in students' lives. And so we're connecting innovative teachers from different schools, all kinds of schools, not just the well-funded private schools with lots of privilege, but like teachers that are making impact and innovating in their schools, especially in different socioeconomic groups. And we're trying to sort of like make sure that they have a network to be able to connect and share best practices, because it's not that hard. Like, what my school teachers did at Friend Central, teachers could do at other schools. And so it's all about just making sure they have access to sort of what works, and we're trying to do that every day. But there's a lot of schools and a lot of teachers and a lot of systems that are hard to break through in that. But that's a really cool place where tech could innovate, I think, and that's what we've sort of leaned on, is more of like a technological solution and ways to connect people. If you check out LRNG online, you guys can learn more about it.
Hi, so thank you so much for coming today. I was just wondering if you think that things would be different if you went on that backpacking trip to India instead of going to grad school, and if so, how?
That's a great question. Oh my God, I wish that I could live like every parallel universe of like every option of what could have happened or did happen. It's hard to know. I mean, I there was something, and look, I'll be really honest with you guys. I was like a blonde, tall, like girl who had worked at some companies, but they were all male dominated. Like business school and having a Wharton degree gave me a sense of like, oh yeah, you can't mess with me, that I don't know if I would have had without that, because there's something about me that felt underestimated all the time, you know, being like who I was, for whatever reason, I just felt like people didn't think I was particularly, and it was probably my own personal thing. But I remember being at business school and taking a negotiations class, and every week we had to negotiate against someone in the class, and you would get a score from the negotiation, and it was all added up. And at the end of the semester, Professor Shropshire, who was my teacher, was like, okay, so I tallied up all the scores from all the negotiations of the entire class, and we have the winner of, you know, the negotiations class, and it ties to Glorious. And I was just like, what? Like, no way. And everybody in the class was like, no way. Because most of the guys in the class, I mean, Wharton even was like less than 30% women at the time. They had all been like iBankers on Wall Street. And I had worked at that weird little Monsoon Micro Studios and then like a little tech company. And I knew nothing about, you know, a lot of these things that these guys were like well versed in. And so when I won, what I realized was my teacher said to me, you have a big power of negotiating, and you know how to get what you want, and you don't even realize your potential. So much of what you guys are going through is just like learning to have like a confidence and a sense of self and ask for what you deserve. And like, I hope that's being instilled in you and that you graduate with like a sense of like confidence, because that's your expectations and your confidence is what's going to take you farther than like being better at like regression analysis. It's why like actually someone from my team who's here, who is a student, but she's full time with me and almost done with her school at USC, but she like came with me to the Alanis Morissette meeting today, and we were with Alanis Morissette for hours, and I can put Sarah in any situation, she's just so like confident. She'll come sit down next to me and be like, I have questions, I need to ask you this, we need to go through this, and she's just not afraid to step up and engage, and that is like gonna get you so far. And it's like the people that I want on my team all the time. So if I had gone backpacking, I think that would have been like a great experience. And maybe it would have led me down an even better path. I have no idea. But I still think I would have always had this doubt about myself that somebody else could out this or that me in business. And artists are often like very insecure about their business knowledge. So the fact that I had like the degree and the business knowledge and the experience is what made John Legend feel confident that I was a better manager than any other big guy manager who had a bigger name than me.
Wharton is one of those schools that, as soon as you say it, you actually think you know the type of person. You know?
Yeah.
So, like, knowing you now, I wouldn't think of you as a Wharton. I went to grad school there as well. And, like, it's just, there's a certain type of, you know, investment banker, hedge fund manager, heavy quant, heavy finance. And so it just keeps you, as soon as someone hears that, they go, huh.
Yeah.
She's sharp, or he's sharp, or they paid their dues. And so it's just interesting that that's never your thing. You didn't want to sort of do that. And yet people probably like, oh, she's badass.
I think it definitely gave me like a leg up in terms, but not so much in the music business, because nobody cares in the music business.
But it'd be the opposite.
But I work a lot with brands now, like, you know, several of our clients are big Fortune 100 companies now, and we're doing social impact strategy for them and getting huge monthly retainers to help advise their approach on how to solve a particular problem in their own community. And I'm proud of corporate America and lots of companies for stepping up to do more of that, because if our government can't do a lot and we seem to get stalemated and our Congress isn't passing anything, then like who's gonna make sure that like Wisconsin isn't one of the worst places in America to be a person of color, which it is, which I didn't know until I met American Family Insurance and the CMO of that company. And she convinced the CEO of the company, because they're the largest employer in the state of Wisconsin, to invest in a social impact strategy for 10 plus years. They're building a whole institute. They want to change the metrics of that state so it's not one of the worst places in America to be a person of color. And that's on metrics of incarceration, violence, all these things. And she's a woman of color from the south side of Chicago, the CMO of this company, this is the fifth largest insurance company in America. She's such a badass. She should also come speak at your class. But you know, like that I think is really important, that like companies are stepping up to try to solve some of these problems too.
Hi, so you're a mom, you're a manager, and you have your own business. And I'm pretty sure you have a lot of other things going on too. So I wanna know personally, how do you handle stress and how do you find a balance? Because I find sometimes like I can wanna crumble, but I wanna know how to stay strong, you know, and just to push through it.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different strategies I've learned, you know, through my life. I'm 43 and I would say the last couple decades of like just trying, you know, took me a while to finally get into a good meditation practice in the morning. Anybody will tell you when you wake up in the morning, do not check your cell phone. Meditate. Have a practice in the morning for setting your day. So like I finally listened to some advice like that and started to almost out of necessity. Like the anxiety and the lack of sleep and all that was getting so bad, I was like, I have to put some healthy practices in my life. So that helps, like 6:30 in the morning, just Kundalini meditation. Headspace is a good option. That's actually a lot of growth in these markets, because I think a lot of people are struggling with, even, you know, people who aren't moms and entrepreneurs. And I'm lucky because I don't have a boss and I don't have to like stay at the office till any particular time. No one, you know, I run my own schedule, but it does require a certain amount of self-discipline. And I think having a meditation practice, working out, eating right, going to therapy, being present, like turning off the phone when I'm with my kids and reading bedtime stories and taking bubble baths with them, like my husband and I balance it a lot really well. Having good partners that you can trust and lean on. Having a great team that you just can lean on, and they start to see you when you're stressed out and they're like, go to a yoga class, you know? I mean, it's not easy, but it's, you just keep trying to juggle as much as you can, and you get comfortable with like imperfection. You know, you just get really comfortable with dropping a few balls every once in a while and just picking them back up. Yeah.
Hi, thank you very much for coming. Can you speak about a time in your life where you experienced the most growth as a person? Maybe it was challenging and you rose to the occasion, and what was your mindset as you were going through that?
I really feel like it's been the last few years for me. I mean, I've, like, motherhood was a whole growth spurt. But the last few years of like having to sort of run this and step up and like be, you know, that's taken me, and it's taken me sort of also admitting weakness, you know, because you can hide really easily if you work for someone else and if you do what's easy and you just dial it in, you know. But when it's your company and it's your dreams come true and you have a lot, and also when you become a mother, it's like you're just so, you need to be efficient, and you need to kind of like stay in it. And so for me, I think like the last 3 years have been the biggest growth of, you know, and I've got more gray hair than ever, but it's also been like so rewarding. And it's, again, it's just taking all the time to like make sure you do the self-care practices so that you can be your better self.
Hi, so my question is about how do you curate your artist roster? In starting your own company, like what kind of changes and kind of like freedoms you got in being in the music industry? And then like what changes you want to see in the music industry going forward?
Yes, well, the first thing, it reminds me of the homework, the success and failures homework. Like I'm gonna do the homework with you guys so we can all. My failures were like how I learned how to curate my artist roster, because now I am so selective about what I pick. Michael Rapino, the CEO of Live Nation, said to me, Ty, you've got all the best artists. You've got so much talent. You have artists that are tremendous and they've been with you for a long time. Don't go sign Kanye West. Like, you don't need the headache. You need to build, don't sign 10 more artists. Build 10 businesses around John Legend. Build 10 businesses around Lindsey Sterling. You know, build 10 businesses around Alanis Morissette. And one of them might work, you know? So I'm constantly thinking about keeping our roster very, very small and very curated, because if you take on just one artist and like, it's so much work and you put in all your time and energy, and then they're like the kind of artists that you can't rely on, and they cancel things or they leave or they don't give a shit about social. So now I have boundaries. I'm like so good at spotting artists that I know I can't work with. I'm like, I love you, but I'm not gonna manage you, you know? Cause I just think it's that being a manager is such like an all-in job. And so I am so careful about onboarding anybody. And we take our time, we do a 6-month trial, we make sure the expectations are right and that everybody understands the roles and responsibilities and what this is gonna be. And that's because I've made mistakes in the past. And it's heartbreaking when you manage an artist and it doesn't work out. And I don't wanna have like a track record of a lot of people that came and went. So for the most part, I think about who we have, not about who I wanna sign. And I think about the artists that we have, how do I build 10 businesses with John Legend? And win the EGOT and like solve world problems with him and like get another hit on the radio, yes. But also like shoot for the moon on everything else. You had like two other questions with that.
So the second one was about like moving out from like a brand and like starting your own company. Mm-hmm. Like what kind of things you were able to change in music?
Well, there are no women run and owned management companies with any of any significant size or scale. So I'm like, I mean, I can't stand how male dominated the music business is. It bothers me. I was told that I couldn't be a manager. You'll never see your kids. If you want to be a mother, you can't be a music manager. And all those norms of all that stuff, you just like in one ear and out the next, and then you create the new norms and you show young people that it's possible. And now there's like a whole bunch of young women managers and we get together all the time and we like trade secrets and, you know, I see who we can collaborate with and we try to build models, like collaborative models, rather than like me saying, sure, young manager, you can come into my company, but I'm gonna subsume you and make you close down your own brand and your own company and give me all your money. That's the only offer available in most management companies. In mine, we started something called the Friends Collective, so managers like Seth Kalin, who has another company called This Fiction, can like join forces with us and collaborate and leverage my 20-person infrastructure. He's just a 3-person management firm, but I didn't need to like make him shut down his brand. So Friends Collective is about like working together with managers along the way and helping lift each other up and sharing infrastructure, because I've got a little bit of like extra, I've got the baddest ass digital team and like the coolest touring people and the greatest creatives, and I'm so proud of our team that I want to share it with people. But that doesn't mean that I have to like take you over, which is all anybody ever offered me. And anything I hated, I won't do. So I just want to see more. I want to see more entrepreneurship in the music business. I want to see more people like leading the right way, and I definitely want to see more women step up and be a part of it, because who better to curate like artistic vision? I mean, why should every young woman who wants to launch a giant pop career or rap career or whatever have to like ask some guy for permission and ask him like for money and ask him what she should wear? Like, most of my roster is women, because so many young women don't even have a place to go in the music business where they feel safe. It's Stacey Smith, USC Studies, that, you know, just have been coming out about the music business. Only 12.5% of songwriters are women. Only 2% of music producers are women. Over the last 6 years, the Grammys, the NARIS organization, nominated 90% of the nominees were male. When Neil Portnow, the head of NARIS, was asked about that the night of the Grammys and why only one woman won on television that night, he was like, well, you know, women need to step up. I think if they wanted to be producers and songwriters, they would find that we're welcoming for them. But that was just like the most incompetent answer I've ever heard. And we all asked for his resignation the next day. But and it's not personal. He's a friend, but it's just, you can't be running like the Grammy organization and not have seen what happened with Oscar So White and Oscar So Male and not prepared your own organization for this. So thank God for USC and Stacey Smith and all the studies that are coming out, because they're changing the entertainment business, and we will hopefully be taking a giant leap forward and seeing inclusivity and gender parity and all these things that we need to be seeing and telling our stories, right? Like, how many people want to hear a story that's like authentic and not just the same old stories written by white guys and white writers' rooms and like executives who got to like greenlight things? John and I have been trying to sell some shows for years. We optioned a book called The Black Count, which is the true story of Alexandre Dumas, who rose from slavery to become a general in the French Revolution. We brought this amazing book that won the Pulitzer Prize to agents and stuff. And this is like 4 years ago, 3 years ago, and they were like, oh, never gonna get made. It's a black historic biopic. Good luck with that. Will Smith passed on the role. Never gonna get this film made. And within 6 months, 12 Years a Slave won the Oscar, and the Sony leaks happened with all those racist emails, and then the phone was like off the hook. Like, Idris Elba could play the lead. Chiwetel, let's do it, we wanna make it. Sony bought the film, like it's all going forward, but it was weird to see like this town sort of change overnight. And it's still not anywhere near where it needs to be. We have so much more progress to make. But you can't have creativity be that, just something's wrong. First you have to acknowledge that there's a problem, and then you have to figure out like what's going on. And when we looked into it, we found out that like women songwriters and producers are often the only one in the room with a whole room of men. And every single woman songwriter I've ever talked to has been not just harassed, but assaulted in those environments. So if you're in a music studio, it's like 2 a.m. and everybody's like, they're getting assaulted. And that's why there's not a lot of women in the room. So anyway, sorry.
Thank you so much for being here. You've been named the most creative people 2017, and I want to ask, where do you look for this creativity, and what usually inspires you? Do you feel like sometimes you pushed to come out with some ideas because it's deadlines, it's a project? So I just want to see how you go by that, and you know how you connect the balance of still being creative but don't be pushed.
Yeah, I think a lot about that, actually. I think a lot about what conditions lead to sort of the most creative outcomes. And I think my most creative ideas come with like time and space. So you really do have to schedule like your phone off, your day walking in nature, like time away. My chief creative officer floats every Friday. Do you know those float tanks? He gets like amazing ideas, and he's one of the most creative people I know. I think pressure can sometimes, but most of the time it's like you need the presence and the time and the space in between. And then you just need the courage to sort of like think out of the box and not just follow what everybody says and like be a little bit wacky and weird and unafraid of that. And like, you know, put yourself in unique, different situations. Some of our most creative thinking came when we were on this prison tour around the country. Like, John was performing at immigration detention centers and women's correctional facilities and jails, and we met like kids in juvenile detention, and it was like in Texas and Washington State, and we've been all over the country, and you just meet so many unique people. And then you get a spark of like a solution for this, you know? So I think creativity is about space and also giving, like putting yourself in unique different situations, like go do something weird. We called it option I in business school. So an option A would be that you stay up all night studying for the finance exam. And option I was you get in a car, you drive to Atlantic City, and you go gamble all night at the casino. And we would often try to pick option I for whatever it was. And it wasn't always like a bad thing, like gambling. It was like going and watching a meteor shower in Valley Forge, or like doing the thing, like going on that trip with him. Like that would have sparked so much creativity. To see entrepreneurs abroad and like how, and that, I mean, those experiences are what you guys need to like take a hold of if you can.
That is such great advice, because you're typically not going to find it in a conference room with a whiteboard. Although she and John mapped out a vision for their future, but I'm sure they were talking about it and thinking about it for years and years. So, you know, saying, you know, let's come up with a business best idea by Friday wins is no way to start a business or no way to get an idea. You are usually in the world doing something interesting. And that's when some of your best ideas come. I'm going to ask the students to thank you in a second. And so I want you to think about some of the lessons that you've taken from Ty. But I wanted to give you the cool thing about what you do and the people with whom you work is that there's just countless stories of ways that you've impacted them and ways that you've changed their lives. This one you may know, I think you know, but I don't think I've ever really told you this. So, and the class hasn't heard this. So. Big music fan and big fan of John's. I'm the youngest of five. I got three older sisters, and we started a concert. I'm from Rochester, New York, so we started a concert in Rochester, New York, a charity concert to raise money for music scholarships, and it benefited the Eastman School of Music, which is like the gem of Rochester, New York, the great music school. And so we started out super small, like local acts. This is in the backyard of my house in Rochester, New York. So it starts out small. It's called Jazz on the Pond. We got a little pond there, and we had a small act. And the next year we said like, maybe we could call some of our friends in California and see if they'd come in and play. So we expanded to a full day of music. So it would be a jazz group from the Eastman School, a contemporary jazz act that you'd hear like on radio. And then we did like a nostalgia act. You know, someone that was big when I was growing up, or you know, your parents were growing up. And so it grew a little bit each year. And so we convinced like Jeffrey Osborne to come, and then Chaka Khan. And then we wound up getting Earth, Wind & Fire to play with our band. And what's cool is we write in the rider that the band, the main act, has to invite up the Eastman students to play on stage with them. So we had like, you know, seniors and grad students playing horns with Earth, Wind & Fire. It was just amazing. So we grew it and grew and grew, and all 100% of the proceeds went to scholarships. And so we get to this year, and we're like, do you think we could like ever get some? And we're not the Gates family, you know, like we don't have the resources to just write a check to anybody. But you want to find people who align with your mission, right? You want to find someone who cares about education, cares about music, particularly, and these scholarships went to people who otherwise probably couldn't afford those schools. And so we said, do you think we could find somebody that would come that's big now? And we submitted an application. I didn't know Ty. We submitted an application through John's charity called the Show Me Campaign at the time, which was access to better education for everybody. And I'll never forget getting this call. I mean, it really was one of those, like, you can't believe it happens. I was actually inviting John to speak at USC, which he eventually did a few years ago, and to play in this concert. And got this call that just said, hey, we got bad news for you. Like, he really wants to come to USC, but he can't put it in the schedule. But the good news is he's going to play your concert, Jazz on the Pond. And I mean, when I told my sisters, they started bawling. It was just one of those things in life you just can't believe happens. So he comes to this, it's a backyard. I mean, I'll show you. This grew into this small concert that we lit up. It's called, you can't really see that, but just a small house. And he comes and he does a solo acoustic set on a piano for 50 minutes. And he starts with like Bruce Springsteen, Dancing in the Dark. The highlight maybe of if I died that night, it would have been okay. Because what he said at the end was, so he came to play by himself, just a piano and him singing, right? That's what he does. He's not gonna rehearse with anybody, he's not gonna play. But we have an all-star band. I mean, sort of like, it is like the all-star team in the NBA. Everett Harp on saxophone and Rick Braun on trumpet and Dwight Sills, like these guys have played for everybody. And so you're waiting for that moment, like before the concert. John's sitting in like our theater room, our green room, and Hassan's there with him, Hassan Smith, and we ask him, will you play an encore, will you play a finale with the band? And it's Marvin Gaye's What's Going On,
and John had just started playing that. But Everett Harp just released the entire album. He played it front to back. And so if you've ever been around great musicians, not good musicians, but great musicians, that can just say, hello, you ready? Let's go. And they dive into this. I'll play the video for you guys another time, the audio. And it just is one of those things. And the Eastman kids come up on stage and start singing and dancing, the background and everything like that. And the coolest thing is that John and Ty were responsible for 80 scholarships. So these are some of the kids that got scholarships. And that was 5 years ago. And it still is like one of the highlights of my life. So I just wanted to thank you for giving my family something that we'll never, ever forget. We still talk about it. Can you believe he came to our backyard? And then the flip side was cool because I got to know him then. And that's sort of when I got to know him and Chrissy. And oddly, I got to go to his backyard when he was with Stevie Wonder and like 100 people performing in his backyard, like one of those weird circles. But just, you know, you think about like how many stories you have heard probably and don't even know about John's music and how it's impacted people. So it's led to 80 different scholarships. So there's people around the world that went to school because of you guys. So I want to close with, there's so many great things that you left us and shared with us about life, about music, about business. I want to hear what lessons you guys are going to take away from Ty's talk in 5 years. I'm going to record it and give it to her. Let me get this. Hands up. Who's ready to go? All right. Speak loudly. Ready? Go.
You don't have to be a jerk to succeed.
You don't have to be what?
To be a jerk to succeed.
Okay. Coming up. Coming around loudly.
Power mapping.
Good.
The number one goal is to make the world better, not worse.
Choose plan I.
But don't go to Atlantic City.
Ask for what you deserve.
Go again.
Ask for what you deserve.
Coming up.
Authenticity.
That's for sure. That's Ty.
Get comfortable with imperfection.
Live every moment vitally and do what you're supposed to do.
Team up with people that share your values.
Did I miss anybody in the middle? Let's thank Ty Stikloris. Thank you. Welcome back from spring break. Have a great week. We'll see you next Wednesday. Fight on.